I'm here at the Academy Museum of Motion Pictures in Los Angeles in the exhibition John Waters, Pope of Trash. And I'm sitting here with the Pope himself, John Waters. Thank you so much for joining us tonight.
Oh, thank you for having me. Are you kidding? I'm still in shock that we're having this show. You know, John Waters at the Academy Museum. What a delicious kind of beginning and ending and all mixed together. I'm very flattered.
We're flattered. As director and president of the museum, it's such an honor to have this exhibition that focuses on your 60-plus year career making films. So I hope we could talk a little bit first about the first time you had a camera in your hands. How did it get started?
I knew nothing about making movies. I didn't go to film school. I was in high school. I had read about underground movies through Jonas Mekas and the Village Voice, even though I lived in Baltimore. I don't know how I got the Village Voice. They didn't sell it in Lutherville, Maryland. Mm-hmm. And my grandmother gave me a Brownie movie camera, and I didn't know there was editing. I just shot it in order. It was very Dogma 95, really very Lars von Trier without realizing it. And I just saw the light reading I could do. It was black and white. And it was filmed in my parents' house, which we called Dreamland Studios, my bedroom. And it was filmed on the roof of my parents' house. And it was an African-American man marrying a white woman, and the wedding was performed by a Ku Klux Klan leader. So right off, I was the same kind of subject matter. I was using ridiculous humor to, I guess, make some kind of political point. And I think if you do make a political point, humor is the best way to do it.
Yes, that combination of shock and humor.
Yeah, and it was very influenced by Theater of the Ridiculous and Edward Albee and, I don't know, the Living Theater and all that kind of stuff at the time. And so it was also very not that original. I had seen other underground movies and everything. I was like a kid. I was like 17.
Wow. We have items in this exhibition, around 400 items over the course of your filmmaking career, from the very beginning up to now.
Including those movies that are never seen today.
Yes.
Because of many distribution problems. But there's versions of them here that you can actually see, and they're restored, and they look amazing, better than they ever looked, right?
Well, let's talk about the film we're about to watch,
okay.
Hairspray.
Hairspray.
So tell us about where you were in your career at that point.
Well, I was not safe to like yet. Hairspray made me safe to like. I had just made Desperate Living, which is probably one of the ugliest, rudest movies I ever made. Pink Flamingos had been an underground success, Female Trouble less so, even though today Female Trouble is liked even more. But I just thought I was obsessed by this teen dance show in Baltimore called The Buddy Dean Show. And I had written an article for Baltimore Magazine about the reunion where they all went and they were in their 40s and they hadn't seen each other and they were doing the dances together without any irony. Right? And it was kind of great because this show was only on in Baltimore. We never got Dick Clark. We never got American Bandstand. And at the peak of its success, it was on 4 hours a day.
Oh my goodness.
Of teens dancing, and they were regulars on the show, and they were huge stars, but only in Baltimore.
Yeah.
And to this day, they're in their 80s, and people go, oh my God, is that Mary Lou? But you know that you grew up in Baltimore if you know who these people are. And they still have reunions. So I had written this article about the reunion. It gave me the idea to make a movie about it. And also was the time when Governor George Wallace was running for the presidential primary in Maryland. And it was the first protest march I ever went to against him. So I decided that it was my story in a way, a white kid that went downtown and you know, met African-American friends and picketed and stuff. But having a big woman who not only gets the guy, is the hero, does everything. And even as Mary Lou, the queen of Buddy Dean Show, said, an African-American girl could have gotten on easier than an overweight girl. She said, no overweight girls ever, ever even applied to be on the show.
Wow.
And when we cast for Hairspray, luckily, Ricky Lake showed up, but only about 8 other people did.
Really?
And then when we did the fourth sequel or something on Broadway that had open casting, thousands of big girls showed up.
Wow.
To do it. So the movie did liberate, I think, the idea that the big girl could be the star of the picture and get the show and everything.
Yeah. And we have these costumes from Hairspray on display in this exhibition. This whole gallery is devoted to Hairspray.
Yeah, all by Van Smith, who's no longer with us, but he did the costumes for all my movies right up to the end. And he's a big, big part of their success.
So, John, I love the musical selections for this film. Could you talk a little bit about how you decided what music to add to the film?
Well, that was the kind of music that I listened to then. In Baltimore, all the white kids listened to Fat Daddy on the radio, who was a black DJ on the black station, WSID. And it's weird. Even racists listened to that. They were so stupid, they didn't even know the difference. And it was weird because the black singers all appeared on the Buddy Dean Show lip-syncing their song and all the white girls, but they had a separate day for African-American kids. But there was no committee. And so everybody wanted to integrate the show. It got, as the 60s built on, it got more and more of an issue, a political issue. And there were big demonstrations in Baltimore against the most famous amusement park, the Northwood Shopping Center. And this was a time of great volatile racial relations. And everybody, I gave it a happy ending in the movie where the show gets integrated. But in real life, they didn't know what to do. And everybody thinks, like in the movie where the black kids snuck on the white day. No, the white kids snuck on Black Day. Because they weren't expecting that. And then it was integrated in the dance, and then they just canceled the show.
Wow.
But at the same time, things were changing so much that all the girls had giant teased hairdos. Suddenly, the first day, the girl had straight ironed hair. That was over, and you had to pick a side. Which
wow.
were you? And the ones that kept the teased hair, that was sort of the end. The ones that flattened their hair became hippies, went on to the 60s, went on to welcome to the 60s.
Yes, yes.
And so it was the hairdos in Baltimore were always a political statement, too.
Mm. When I think about all the issues that you raise in this film, in such a loving way, but also in a really direct way, they're still relevant. And Hairspray has evolved over time.
Well, I always say it's the Trojan horse. It's the most devious movie I ever made because it snuck in mid-America.
Mm.
And now kids are doing Hairspray in grade school. It's confusing because Divine plays Edna as a man, but that's a secret between the actors and the audience. Tracy doesn't think her mother's trans. Mm. That's not the plot.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't know how to get mad at it. And that's how you do. You sneak in, and then it's too late. And everybody's families are applauding it, and it encourages interracial dating. It is two men singing a love song to each other. But they don't notice.
Yes.
And that's the truth. If you can entertain somebody so much and make them laugh, they don't notice that maybe they don't agree.
Wow. And this has snuck into Broadway and then snuck into
Broadway
another.
Broadway made it go way, way even further.
Yes.
The Broadway production that reached mass America. And I've seen it now because in high schools and grade schools, you can't cast by weight or race or anything anymore. So I've seen a skinny black girl play Tracy and the parents go, what? The kids don't care.
Yeah.
They don't even notice.
Yeah.
Which is healthy.
It is healthy.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's a new thing that's even more odd in a way, you know, that the kids don't notice, really.
Wow. And we have on display in the exhibition your ticket to the Broadway show.
I know, my opening night, Broadway. I remember it was my parents finally could say they liked it without lying.
This was Divine's last film.
It was Divine's last film, but we certainly didn't know that when we were making it. But Divine got the best reviews of his career because we had established Divine as this frightening person that we thought up to scare hippies. Divine didn't want to be a woman, he wanted to be Godzilla. But he always played this frightening, aggressive person. And then when he did the exact against type and played a loving mother and East Baltimore housewife in a house dress, he got rave reviews.
Mm. Well, we have some amazing costumes that Divine
yeah.
wore in this exhibition, as well as the wig that Deborah Harry wears that explodes
I
at
know.
The end
so
of the film.
So we must have had several of them.
Right.
Yeah,
it looks
yeah.
like it's in great shape.
Yeah,
must not
Chris
have been
Mason
the same
did
one.
Those wigs, and that was really heavy to wear in that scene. But yeah, Debbie was great. She was really great playing it. And Sonny Bono, who, when he was young, worked for Specialty Records, an African-American label that was Little Richard's label, and Lloyd Price. He was the white A&R guy that
mm-hmm.
found it, you know.
Mm.
So he knew Ruth Brown when Ruth Brown was in Hairspray, and she was great. I grew up listening to her music. So it's all based on some kind of weird truth in a way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Crybaby definitely had original music and old music too. But yes, it was my first musical, my only real musical.
So what was it like for you directing a musical? How was that different from your approach to directing your previous films?
Well, filming a dance scene is not that different from filming a music scene. You film it many times from different angles and you cut it. But we tried to do Dave Inslee, who was the DP on that movie. We watched a lot of Elvis movies and imitated some of the camera moves. It was the first real Hollywood movie I made. So I had a budget of, I forget, $10 million or something,
wow.
which was a fortune for us because Hairspray was 2.8. But it was great. I mean, there's some things the head of the test screening said to me, what's the norm we test you against?
Had you done test screenings before this one?
With Hairspray, they all said that they wouldn't cheer for a fat girl. So it makes no sense. It's not what you would think of anything. So to me, test screenings, you can learn from them. You can see a thing that didn't work. You didn't explain one piece, so you hold the shot longer. But as far as making the audience, they say, who did you like least? And people say, the villain. You're not supposed to like the villain, and they want you to make them like him. Why? That's the villain. So I went through it. I learned how to do it. But there's scenes I have, like in Crybaby. They let me keep it in, but it tested badly, where Allison is so upset that Crybaby leaves her that she saves her tears in a jar and then drinks them. And I've met people later that said, I did that after seeing the movie, and my parents caught me and sent me to a psychiatrist.
So your films, and you yourself, have always embodied a spirit of rebelliousness. This film has some characters who are juvenile delinquents, as they're called, and embrace that.
Well, sure, when I was young, that was the worst thing you could be, but that's what everybody wanted to be. The drapes, which was what they called them in Baltimore. You can ask anybody in Baltimore over 60, were you a drape or a square? And they don't say, what do you mean? They just give the answer. But both were cool. Squares didn't mean you were a nerd. It meant you were probably more preppy. You turned into Joe College, it was, kind of. And you ironed your hair, and then you became a hippie. You weren't like Elvis with tight pants and the girls with, you know, prom dresses and the black nylons with, like, seams and ballet shoes. Oh, they had a whole look.
Wow.
This movie was about class. That's what it was. Hairspray was about race. This was about class.
So let's talk about the casting of this film. I mean, you have a multi-generational cast in this film that is really just eclectic.
No, I think I invented stunt casting on this movie, and I never did it again. Mm. I mean, Johnny Depp was the star, and Johnny Depp at the time was Justin Bieber in America. He was the teen idol, and he hated it. And I've said this before. He said, I hate being a teen idol. I said, stick with us, we'll kill that. And we did, in the right way. And then Tim Burton came in next and worked with him. So it did work for him to change his career. And he was great in it. I got along with him perfectly from the beginning. He got along with everybody. We're a happy group, and we had everybody. The most shocking person to me was that David Nelson was there from Ozzie and Harriet. And I mean, I grew up watching that, and I could not believe he was sitting in my living room. And Patricia Hearst was his wife in it, with Tracy Lords as the daughter.
Incredible.
I thought, how did this ever happen?
Because of you.
Yeah, I know.
Yes.
So it was exciting. It was, and the cast was so bizarre that when we would all go in a restaurant, people would run. They wouldn't come over and ask for autograph. They were scared.
We have a whole gallery in this exhibition on your career that's focused on Crybaby.
Yeah.
Two of the items that I love the most are the two leather jackets.
Well, one was Crybaby and one was the little kid that wore in a snare drum. And he's maybe 40, 50 years old now. And he donated his little jacket and the Crybaby jacket.
Yeah, it's wonderful to have them together. And to see just the humor in just looking at the objects that you've used for your films.
Well, we even marketed then a Crybaby tear that you could glue on your face and wear. When it came out, it's weird though, it was not a hit. And it became a Broadway show, it was not a hit either. Mm-hmm. The problem with the Broadway show, it was the sexiest Broadway show for the whole family. That doesn't work. and the movie was made to be, of course, a big thing for Johnny Depp. We had the first test screening, all the girls screamed like an Elvis movie, but that never once happened again. They smelled a rat, me, because we were satirizing his teen idleness. We were satirizing musicals, all the kind of things from the 50s, Elvis movies, but that audience didn't know that or get that. Mm. They wanted Johnny to be a teen idol again.
Sure.
He should have been because he looked so sexy and great in it. That scene where he teaches Allison how to French kiss is kind of amazing. And she was fresh out of high school. She didn't go to her prom and came the first day of rehearsal in my living room. She had to make out with Johnny Depp and she fainted. I don't blame her. I would have.
Well, one of the things that's so remarkable about your career is the way that you have found and worked with people for so many years and then discover new talent all the time.
We discover new talent. And then, like, Ming Stoll's been in every one of my movies, Mary Vivian Pierce. But then we put them in with Melanie Griffith and Kathleen Turner and Tracy Ullman. So I keep mixing them and doing it because I think a movie's like a dinner party. You want a great guest list.
Yes.
And everybody that comes, the main thing I say is don't wink at the audience. Say it like you believe it. That's funny. You don't have to tell them it's funny. If you have to tell them it's funny, it usually isn't.
Wow. Yes. Yeah. Yes. That's great advice. Well, so many of your collaborators also participated in the catalog that we have for this exhibition.
Oh, yeah. What they had saved, everything. I was amazed to see some of it. I didn't even remember that existed. I mean, there were different ad campaigns for Cecil B. DeMille. I don't even remember ever seeing them. Or even my little old books that have, like, the grosses and my receipts, 25 cents for lipstick, you know, things, you know, it was still there. So I was somehow together enough to do it even then. I guess my dad taught me that.
Wow. So next up, we're watching Polyester. Mm-hmm. And I would love for you to set this up for our audience.
Well, Polyester was the first movie I made that wasn't a midnight movie. It was rated R. It was shot in 35 millimeter. And we shot Notorama, which is where you got a scratch and sniff card when you came in and scratched the numbers when she smelled them on the screen, which I had always wanted to do to have kind of a gimmick to go along with it. And people did pay me money all over the world to smell a fart.
Oh, my gosh.
They did. It's a universal urge to smell a fart and hand someone money. And in it, I wanted Divine to be completely against type and play an alcoholic housewife, but this was kind of based on a 50s kind of family and everything. And the two children, one of them is a foot stomper and the other one is a go-go girl that does go-go dancing in school for a quarter. But Divine got the best reviews then because he was against type and he was playing something so different than the critics remembered him as in Pink Flamingos or Female
Sure.
Children.
What do you remember about shooting that film? Because you shot it on location.
Well, the neighbors hated us a lot and called the police, and I don't blame them because we had generators outside and we're shooting all night. The thing I really remember was the first time we had a real Hollywood star, Tab Hunter, in it, and he took a great risk to do that movie and come and kiss and make out with Divine, which today sounds like nothing. Then it was something, believe me, because they would say, Tab Hunter kissing the mouth that ate shit, basically. And they got along great. From the moment, I could only afford to hire him for a week, so we saw all the movie around him and just his week. He loved Divine. He made another movie that he produced afterwards with Divine called Lust in the Dust. So he was a great team player. He got into our spirit right away, and I'm still friends with him up to the day he died.
Wow. Say more about your love of gimmicks, like Odorama. Where did that come from?
Well, I grew up with William Castle, who had buzzards going off under the seats, skeletons flying. And I knew that there was smell-o-vision, the first one, but they pumped the smells in a theater and they couldn't get them out, and they had all good smells. I knew that was a bad idea. Elizabeth Taylor owned that. Her husband did
that's
it,
right,
Mike Todd.
That's right.
And I got the idea because the meanest critic that hated me for the New York Post wrote, if you ever see the name John Waters on the marquee, walk on the other side of the street and hold your nose. I thought, now there's a blurb. But then I thought, well, okay, I'll make a movie that stinks. He gave me the idea to. So
fabulous.
Even bad reviews help. It was the scratch and sniff thing, and I developed it through 3M had a library of smells, and we developed it through that. Sarah Risher at New Line Cinema, we worked on that. And so it came to be just another gimmick, but it worked. It totally worked. It did get people to come, definitely. And later there was ones on television you could get it. They had in France, you could get it in the local 7-Eleven, or, you know, you could get it everywhere. And even the doctor that explains Odorama in the beginning, there's a joke, he says, this is Odorama. And the screen just goes that bigger, like Cinerama. That was in the beginning of Cinerama. They said, this is Cinerama. The screen. He said, this is Odorama. The screen gets tiny. And he was played by the head of Maryland Public Television at the time.
Is that right?
And the neighbors were in Polyester. The neighbors that were in it, playing the protesters, are the neighbors that liked us. The other neighbors were in the house calling the police. Yeah.
But my goodness, the range of odors that you give us in this film.
It ends with a nice one. It clears your palate as you leave.
You work with so many of your stalwart Dreamlanders in this film. At this point, where were you in terms of your relationship building with this amazing crew?
Well, I had the same crew and everything, but I worked with New Line Cinema, who was distributing my films and paid for some of this for the first time. It was the first time I had Hollywood backing. And so we had a lot of music people. I used Debbie Harry, had a lot to do with the music. She got Bill Murray to sing the song about Francine. Steve Bader's is in it, the first punk rocker I ever worked with. So I always hired musicians. Later, I had Iggy Pop. I always hired musicians. They're good. They know how to play themselves. They've been playing themselves as singers on stage.
Well, we have some amazing artifacts from Polyester in this exhibition. And what the curators, Jenny He and Dara Jaffe, have shared is that they went back to the place where you shot it, knocked on doors, and they were able to find some incredible things, including photographs that were taken.
Yeah, all the neighbors had moved except one, and we had a yard sale at the end to get rid of all the stuff, and he bought some of the stuff, and it's here today. He lent it.
Yes, this bar cart that we see.
Yeah, right in the beginning when Divine is with her husband, and he must have been one of the neighbors that liked us.
Absolutely, yes. I want to know what it's like for you going through this exhibition and seeing things that you had saved some things, but there was a lot here that other people had, and just seeing it all put together.
It's like an old 50s show that most of this audience will be too young to remember, but John Waters, This Is Your Life, where they come out and bring a babysitter you had, or this kind of thing. It was like that, thinking, oh my God, I remember that. Or just seeing people in the background of that aren't with us anymore. Just a lot of personal thoughts come think about how did we ever get all these made? How did we do this? We went out every night then too. How did we do this?
And then your fans. I mean, over the years, you have been so present and positive and responsive.
Well, the fans are great. They've been incredibly loyal. They've allowed me to never get a real job my whole life. We have a whole wall of fan art here, which is just a small portion of it from
because
my
studio. Because you keep
studio.
It at home, right?
I have it all hung, yeah.
Yes, paintings yeah. And dolls.
I like
dolls.
The bad ones even better.
Oh, well, it's just incredible to be able to highlight your career here. And also, I want to thank you because you've been so wonderful, even to the museum team, everyone who's worked on putting this
exhibition
together. Well,
the museum team did an amazing job, and they've been working on it for 4 years. I can't imagine why I wouldn't be incredibly thankful.
Thank you so much, John.
You're welcome.